All right, before we get into this false flag rapture update, let's take a moment to practice the continuity problem technique. I don't have a false rapture problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The false rapture scenario has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. This is your safety. This is your safety net. Because the more you're aligned with the vision of oneness, the more that protects you from all the false scenarios that are just whirling around at this time. And let's take a look at the false flag scenario. We have this Malaysian plane situation, which is a huge sign. Several months ago, I had this dream that showed me at a certain time this spring, there would be a very significant crash take place. And it showed me a particular time when the blossoms were on this tree and the grass was starting to grow, and I was trying to pin it down, and I eventually said, early March is the likely time for this crash. Well, the plane went missing on the 8th of March. So, and it's still missing, all right. This is very significant. The world's fixated on this event. It's a symbol, it's a sign of what's to come, in my opinion. What happened was the plane was going along towards China, Beijing, right? And then suddenly it took just a complete hard left turn. It broke contact with everyone else, basically, and said, we're going to take a hard left turn. Then it went missing and nobody knows where it is, but presumably it's at the bottom of the Indian Ocean. With all passengers on board perishing. What I see this is a symbol, a foreshadowing of what's to come in this world. The world is going to take a hard left turn towards a hard left stance. The left, the progressive left, is going to suddenly take a very abrupt, hard stand. And the world is going to just go into this leftist mode severely, very severely. They're going to breaking off communication means it's going to be arbitrary. Like, it's not going to go through the normal processes of give and take, check and balances. It's sort of going to be a dictatorial sort of hard left turn, and the world will go along with it. It's sort of anyway. Then, in my opinion, could be the false flag rapture, which gets people up into these ships that supposedly are God's vehicles to bring people to heaven, and they perish there, and just like the passengers have now just completely disappeared. You know, nobody knows where they went. They maybe never will find them. Same thing with this false rapture. Now, why is this false rapture taking place? I believe it is similar to the Holocaust in World War II, where the Germans felt that the certain people were contaminating the gene pool of the planet, and they needed to be gotten rid of. This is a very similar to that, except this is on the ideological level. The leftists believe that religious people are contaminating the ideological collective of the planet, and they need to be gotten rid of. Kind of like when the communists, you know, take over like China, etc. Religion is outlawed. You know, like they came into Tibet, you know, wiped out all the monasteries and just wreaked havoc on the country. So it's interesting that going towards China and then a hard left turn and then the people perishing, see, disappearing, without a trace, nobody knows, you know, no closure, gone. Like a false flag rapture, which is all these metallic, white metallic spaceships, or they appear in the sky and the religious people think this is the rapture. Now, how are they convinced that this is the rapture? This is an important point. I've said that those who are going to convince them are largely are going to be female people, females who are going to appear as if they're the Virgin Mary or the Virgin of Guadalupe or some goddess-like figures. I call them the Dakini stewardesses, the goddess Dakini stewardesses, the Dakini stewardesses, the stewardesses, right? The stewardesses come down from these ships and say, folks, Come on up. This is Jesus is waiting, or whoever God is waiting for you. And I guarantee you that you can trust the mother. We represent the divine mother principle. Come on up, you know. And so there's all these various cults around the world right now. They're very much into the Virgin Mary, the Virgin of Guadalupe, the mother, the goddesses, all this stuff. And that is, they're getting all psyched up, thinking that they can trust implicitly in these female figures that tell them that they're from God. Well, I can tell you something about all that. Having a long association with this whole situation, looking at it, you absolutely cannot trust them. You absolutely cannot trust them. They're deceivers. They are deceivers. And do not go into any metallic ship, for sure. And I don't care if you think you're following the Virgin Mary in there. Do not go into it. I was deceived, or there was an attempt to deceive me, by this Virgin Mary figure. By this this goddess that said that she's working for Jesus, that she's a co-redeemer with Jesus, and that you can trust in her plan, that she's bringing you to Jesus. That is the whole thing. It turned out to be a total lie. Total lie, okay. But very convincing, very convincing. What they're really doing is they're working with this agenda on this planet to purge the planet of all religious-minded people. Now, they see that the religious-minded people are holding the planet back from the advancement that it needs to take place. So just like the Germans wanted to, the Nazis, let's say, wanted to completely eliminate the Jews and the Gypsies and various people from the planet, absolutely annihilate them from the planet. This program is an attempt to annihilate religious people from the planet. You know, the third secret of Fatima was that the war against the religious people and the church, and the enormous bloodbath here in this world, and the drastic problems that would come about in this massive war against religious people. Well, that is coming. That's the hard left agenda. And the hard left, why are they so confident? You know, this thing is puzzles everybody, right? I know everyone's puzzled. Like, it's in the back of their mind, they're saying, how come these people are so sure that they're going to win and their agenda is going to win? It doesn't add up. It doesn't add up. Well, they haven't factored in this false flag rapture. That is the trump card the left is holding. The left has been working with extraterrestrials for a long time, actually. And there's this overall Illuminati New World Order situation that is really designed with this religious eugenic program in place, with the help of certain very malevolent ETs who are trying to carry out this holocaust against religious-minded people through this false flag rapture. Okay. So there has been this massive attempt on this planet to build up this implicit faith in female leadership. That females, if they tell you what right you should do it, then that's what you should do without questioning it. This is designed, I believe, to get all these religious-minded people trusting in this false flag rapture, so that they can be taken up into these ships and eliminated. And the people on the ground here, everyone will say, I had nothing to do with it. No guilt for me. Like the Nazis, there's a lot of guilt because of what they did to the Jews and others. But in this false flag rapture, it's like the people on the ground will say, oh, I had nothing to do with it. It wasn't my doing. It was their own stupid folly, and that their idiocy for believing in God, and it's their own fault. See, and so clean hands, clean slate, move forward. That's how the left works. That's why they're so confident. Like, people think, why are they so confident and happy? Their agenda, they'd have to annihilate us all. But how are they going to do that? And wouldn't it be on their conscience and stuff? So something doesn't add up in this world. And this is the missing piece, is this false flag rapture. Plug that in, and you understand why the left is so confident, and they feel with no conscience about what they're going to do and go forward, because they're going to have this alliance, and these malefic ETs are going to take care of the extermination for them, and it'll be done up in the atmosphere, actually, and won't be done so much on the ground. And they'll say, well, these people left on their own accord, trusting in God, and look what God did to them. See, you can't trust God at all. God destroyed them. It's very nasty. Very, very nasty. Now, so there's all, you know, and having been pressured to try to help out with this thing and saying, no, there's something wrong with this. I was, I collected all the pictures of Anandamayi Ma, and I have, you know, just about every picture that's ever been taken of her. And I used to make all these videos with her pictures. And then something just said, you know what, don't do that. That's not right. I said, huh? And so ever since then, I've been wondering, why am I not supposed to use her picture? And I always think, hey, it's a good thing for the world that people need to see this great female saint, you know, who brought the truth to the world, which is very true. But I've always been warned, don't do it. You'll be very, very sorry if you do that. If you try to pursue promoting her picture and identifying people with her, etc., around the world. Why? Is it genuine saint? No question. Because what these ETs and the leftist and ETs agenda is, they want people to associate certain female figures, like a goddess-like female figure, who is totally reliable and totally trustworthy. They want you to associate that in your mind with these Dakini stewardesses from the ET ships, so you trust them. So you trust them, and if they say, "Yeah, I'm here. I'm helping Anandamayi Ma. I'm helping the Virgin Mary," people say, "Oh, okay, I can trust you. I can believe in you entirely." That kind of thing. So I was been warned off. Don't use those pictures at this time. It's going to create this false association of trust in people's minds with these false, malefic goddesses or stewardesses of these UFOs, who are going to convince people to get into the ships. I remember there was some other person making YouTubes. I can't remember his name, but he talked about the 2012 and it didn't happen, etc. But what he did say is, don't get on these metallic ships. Whatever you do, there's reptilians, they're going to annihilate you. I think he's probably accurate about that. So there is this attempt to dupe the religious people of the world. And there are these cults going around talking about all these earth changes, all this catastrophe, and all this kind of stuff like that, to convince the people that they should then rapture off the planet. But it always tends to go to the Virgin Mary, doesn't it? And Jesus is just somebody off of, you know, on the sidelines, and it's really the Virgin Mary speaking. This is a trick. This is a trap. Jesus doesn't talk that way. You know, all these channelers and stuff, Jesus doesn't talk that way. Does not. If you want to know how Jesus talks, study A Course in Miracles. Okay. This is someone who's to be trusted. This other stuff is all at the level of emotion and personality and glamour and goddess worship, actually. Remember, the goddess religions were in control of this planet for almost the entire history of this planet. Just up until recently, and they basically have made a resurgence into the monotheistic religions that supposedly replaced goddess worship. And now essentially what's happening is it's goddess worship again. The Great Mother is materialism, secular worship of secular materialism, actually. So there's an attempt to stampede people into the ships through the idea that the world is coming to an end and you must get on these ships for safety. Now, you see, there's a grain of truth to all of that. There's some truth. It's a half-truth. It's a half-truth. There are problems coming. But getting on those ships isn't the answer. That's not the answer. Not those ships. Not that. That's a false rapture. People should, to be safe, you have to be attuned to the vision of oneness. This is your goal. This is your goal. Whether you're taking off this planet or not taking off this planet, the fact is, vision of oneness remains my goal, period. I'm not aiming for some guru, anything like that. I'm aiming for the vision of oneness. That cures our one problem, which is the continuity problem, for sure. It absolutely cures our true problem, the real deep down problem, which is fear of returning to reality. the true oneness of all reality, the totality without a second, the non-relative, entirely non-relative, non-localized, non-defined reality, the totally harmony-free reality, because there's only one. There's nothing that needs to harmonize with. You see, it's not harmonizing. Truth does not harmonize with lies. Truth is not a harmonizer. It is a beer. Okay. Reality is not harmonizing. It's being. So the emotionalism of religious people is what the progressives hate. They really hate it. And you know, on one level, you can understand what they're talking about. But their remedy is completely, you know, vicious and not appropriate. But they want to purify this world for the fourth dimensional agenda. And in order to do that, they got to get rid of all these religious people. I mean, that's been their agenda from the get-go, and it's very, very obvious. If you just look on internet boards and stuff, and brings up religious or emotional religious thing about Jesus or whatever, they just go ballistic. And their attitude is basically, you need to be eliminated. You need to be eliminated right now. That's the leftist agenda. Okay, let's just acknowledge it, realize that's what it is. They want to carry out a holocaust against religious-minded people, remove them from the planet entirely, and then move on. You know, let's move on. That's their thing. Let's time to move on is their whole thing. They'll say, you know, it's time finally to move on and put this cancer, you know, get rid of this cancer off the planet as they see it. Now, my perspective is all people are suffering from exactly the same problem, the continuity problem. So are these religious-minded people have a continuity problem? Of course. Do the secular materialists have a continuity problem? Of course. All have the exact same problem. And they don't see that. They're caught in the personality ego dynamic of projecting, not knowing what their problem is, misperceiving their problem, projecting it out on the religious-minded people and saying we need to get rid of them and then we'll be happy. Not true. That will not cure their continuity problem in the slightest bit. So it takes a great deal of compassion and patience at this time, because there is this super polarized situation in the world, right? That the world seems to just be stuck and we don't know what is going to happen. But the progressives are super confident, right? He says, well, we're going to move on and it's going to be no problem. And we say, huh? What are you talking about? What about all these people who are opposing you? You see? There's a plan for all that. They have a plan. And the religious-minded people have not factored in the ETs equation into it, okay? You have to factor them into the equation. They have been at the very root planning of all of this, actually. They've been involved in this planning from the very get-go. And actually, the progressive secular materialists are actually just their pawns, you know. They really want to take over this planet for themselves. Okay, and they can't stand the religious mindset, the religious mindset. And so the world turns. As the world turns, we're headed towards this scenario. So the Malaysian plane is a huge, huge tip-off. Huge, huge tip-off. I think there was a catastrophic failure on board. The cabin was depressurized. The pilot plunged the plane down to 12,000 feet too, so the people could breathe, and they were overcome, and the plane was on autopilot, and it just took them out over the Indian Ocean or something. But the bottom line is, these people were eliminated. Okay, they're not parked somewhere in some paradise somewhere. No. You know, that's fanciful, wishful thinking. Unfortunately, that didn't take place. So this false rapture, people think, oh, these are so fortunate, these people have been taken to paradise. And of course the stewardesses, Dakini stewardesses, Dakini is like a Tibetan word or something, an Eastern word for these beautiful goddesses that seem so divine and radiant and lovely and everything, you know. They they will come down and assure everyone, said, and there will be some that go up to the ships and come back down, accomplices, who say, yeah, everything's great. We're being taken to paradise. It was unbelievably great. So this is the story. But keep in mind, the real paradise is the vision of oneness. That's the real paradise. Now that can be seen here, it can be seen, and maybe some will be, but not from the false flag rapture. That's not its agenda. It's not its agenda. That doesn't mean that all ETs are the super malevolent, death camp, exterminators, holocausters, and not all of them are that way. That is for sure. Jesus is not that way. That is for sure. But many speak in Jesus' name, claiming various things. We know that. But Jesus will point you to the vision of oneness for sure. A Course in Miracles is brilliant, brilliant, brilliant work. Just unbelievably intelligent, compassionate, love in action, compassion in action, which is this incredible, clear explanation of what troubles us, what bothers us, what's our problem. And you can see that Jesus calls the vision of Christ, or the vision of oneness, is exactly the same. It's just a different terminology, that the oneness of all of us, of everything, oneness without a second, oneness, uncompounded oneness. This reminds us of the nature of reality and enables us to wake up from our coma. Okay. So, of course, all the religious minded stuff, much of it is still personality, all personality stuff. But so is the progressive liberal secular materialist. It's all personality. It's all delusional stuff. It's just two illusions fighting each other, trying to triumph over one another, and claiming that their triumph means that they must be true, that they must be truth. So how does illusion become true by triumphing over another illusion? To explain that one to me. And I'll tell you how it works is the two illusions are actually in cahoots with one another. They don't realize that. They appear to be mortal enemies. But what they're really doing, this play of illusions triumphing over one another, it's actually, we're using our will to do this, but we're not admitting it. And we're doing this so we can claim that this illusion triumphed over the other, therefore it must be true. So the secular materialists will claim that they must be right because they triumphed over the religious-minded people. Is it like that? It's just unbelievable, but it's true. This one. So at a very hidden, deep place, the two sides are in cahoots with one another, because what they're really trying to do is gain the sacrifice of God. Okay, and so they think if they can make any illusion triumph, and make this triumph seeming to be, make it means that illusion is true, that means it's really a triumph over God. Okay, and so for these godly people to be destroyed by the secular materialists, that will appear to be evidence that the secular materialists are somehow greater than God, you see. And then that will then give credence to the whole notion that we can be greater than God, that spirit can be greater than God. So the two illusions fighting with one another, they're actually in cahoots with one another. Okay, the two puppets, the puppeteer is making it seem like there's a conflict between the two. But the puppeteer is doing this to try and basically con God, actually, which is impossible. So remember, both these sides are being played by the puppeteer, which is the ego, which is really our projected will. It's really our projected will is the puppeteer, playing both sides, and one gets rid of the other, and then we think, this one triumphed, this one must be true. See, this one must be real, it must be true. It defeated the other puppet. This is what's happening. So the goal is not a person, a guru, a savior, anything like that. Those are all concretized reifications of abstractions. The goal is the vision of oneness. That is the goal. That's always the goal. Not devotion to some guru, some saint, some savior, anything like that. It's the goal is the vision of oneness. Not even worshiping God is the goal, because that is our worship of God is worshiping a concretization. That's not solving the continuity problem. Jesus told us, look, you can curse me, you could even curse God, but don't curse the Holy Spirit. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is what leads us to the vision of oneness. Our problem is this continuity problem, not the worshiping of God. We worship God by abiding in reality. And we will not wake up from our coma until we be reminded of what reality is like. So first, we have to have the vision of oneness and abide in the vision of oneness. That's the first thing we do. So that's way, way, way more important than trying to worship God, because we'll only be worshiping our own concepts of God, just concepts. And that's self-idolatry, actually. Worshiping concepts is idolatry. The vision of oneness is the reminder from the Holy Spirit of what reality is like. So that's our goal. That is our goal. No matter where we are, we could be in paradise, we could be under this planet, we could be in paradise, it's still the same goal. That's certainly a very non-conflicted, beautiful place where we're able to do deep process of consideration, a vision of oneness, deep continuity practice. Enables us to get to trust in the practice that we won't be, you know, set upon by conflict and stuff once we do this. And that certainly helps a lot. There's no question about it. You can be in a very vulnerable position as far as moving into a different comfort zone. And you can just let that settle in gently. It's like a nursery for a child. You know, being in a nice nursery is a good thing for a little infant. You can settle into the changes and adjust to this world. We can adjust to the realization of the vision of oneness. We can adjust to it better in a certain environment. That is true. But the goal is still the same. People say, religious-minded say, oh, we're going to meet Jesus face to face. I'm finally going to be able to hug Jesus. And you know, is that the goal? The goal is the vision of oneness. I'm telling you, for sure it is. Jesus is adamant about that. This is, in the Course in Miracles, he is not suggesting we should worship Jesus or worship God. He's saying you must take the intermediate step first. This vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, with no exclusions, no specialness, everything as one. That is your goal. And I'm sure that Jesus is right about this. Having glimpsed it myself, I'm positive, certain about this. This is true. No question about it. So the religious-minded people, they think, I'm going to be in the arms of Jesus and see him. And no, that's not the goal, actually. If Jesus were to show up right here, right now, you know, my goal would still be the vision of oneness. I'd say, do you have any suggestions for me, for my practice, you know? What else could you say, really? Do you have any suggestions for my practice? I'm not going to go crazy or go bonkers. Oh, Jesus is here. No, because my goal is still the same. I have to get to the vision of oneness. And that is this shift in perception. Where everything is included, it's all-inclusive, seamless awareness. It's this all-inclusive, seamless awareness. And shifting into that, we have to do that. So whether Jesus is sitting next to us or not, we still have the goals the same. We still have to get to this seamless awareness, this perfect inclusivity, this irrelevance are of our irrelevance. Our planned irrelevance is irrelevant, totally irrelevant. We need to get to this vision of oneness, whether we're surrounded by saints and God and Virgin Mary or whatever, or not. Same goal. So the problem is that the secular materialists and the religious-minded people are at loggerheads, and they've demonized one another because both sides are unaware of this continuity problem. If they were aware of this, the whole thing would not take place. They'd be humble, and they'd say, "Wow, I'm not ready, you know, I'm not ready to meet God yet. I have this intermediate step I have to take." And the second materialist would realize, "Wow, what we're trying to do is out of fear of the continuity problem, trying to make this world a utopia or something. That's not the answer. The vision of oneness is the answer. So we got to back off and let's everybody just be sober and serious in the mood of repentance, because we all have exactly the same problem." People realize we all have exactly the same problem. We've just been defending against it in different ways. And it's our defenses that are fighting one another. Okay, it's our defenses that are fighting one another. There is a common ground for everything, everyone. The continuity problem is the common ground for everyone. Everybody has exactly the same problem. They're just defending against it in different ways. But the problem is the same. We've forgotten reality. That's our problem. Everybody has the same problem. Reality is not different. It's exactly the same for everyone. So everybody has forgotten reality. But how we defend against this fear can vary, you know, wildly, actually. There's just infinite defensive strategies in conflict and turmoil. And everybody thinks that someone else's strategy is harming theirs, so they have a right to kill them, you know. But if they're truly humble, they'll realize, hey, you know, I got a severe problem. I have to work on that. What other people do is their own business, but I'm working on that, and it's my problem. I have forgotten reality. It's not someone else didn't do it to me. I forgot. Okay? And the vision of oneness is a solution to this. And this has nothing to do with attacking other people and whatever they do, etc. I have to do my own spiritual practice. I have to work on this continuity problem. Don't blame others for your own failure. You have to work on it yourself. There's no other way. Getting rid of somebody is not going to be the answer. Your answer is a soft landing into the vision of oneness, which means you have to do right spiritual practice. Nobody is exempt from this. Everybody has to do right spiritual practice. Align with the continuity problem. Okay, align with the continuity problem. So, I don't have a false rapture problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a secular materialist problem, progressive problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have any problem. I don't have any progressive secular materialist problem. I only have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The vision of oneness is the only value there is. And you could say, I don't have a religious-minded problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. Vision of oneness is the only value that there is for me. The only value, because it resolves. It's the only resolution to the continuity problem. So we all have exactly the same problem, and we all have exactly the same remedy. Everyone, without exception. There's no way around it whatsoever. So we all, you know, if we could see this, we would relax. We would relax. We'd back off a little bit from what's happening right now. But clearly, people are ignorant that they have a continuity problem. They think the problem is the people out there who are not agreeing with their defenses towards the continuity problem, actually. And they're interfering with their defensive structure. I mean, religious-minded people and the concretization of God and Jesus and Virgin Mary and all this stuff, that is a defense against the continuity fear. It is a defense. 100% for sure. The sacrificial religions and all this. It's a defense. And so for them, it's super important because they're terrified of the continuity problem, terrified of it. And they don't know how to deal with it. Okay, so they got this defense. Second, materialism is also a total defense against the continuity problem, which is, hey, what continuity problem? We're going to build a paradise here. We don't have to go back home. No, you know, no problem anymore. That too is a defense against the continuity fear. So both sides have not yet heard the true gospel, which is right spiritual practice to our soft landing into the vision of oneness. I have a continuity problem, but the vision of oneness is there for me, and that can have a soft landing into it through right spiritual practice. They have not yet heard that gospel. Okay, they have not. And therein lies the problem. Now, the gospel can come various different ways. It comes through various different traditions. There have been teachers who have taught that throughout time here on this planet. Recently, for me, A Course in Miracles certainly brought the right gospel into the world in explaining the vision of oneness, the vision of Christ, and giving us practices to have a soft landing into it. That is what we need. It is what we need. Healed perception. So we're at this difficult juncture of the world now, for sure. The Malaysian plane thing is tipping us off. The dream I had, I also saw a super hard turn, and the crash occurred, and big problems then. You know, really bad scene is going to take place. So, just updating you, calming everyone down, reorienting them, realizing, you know, you don't have to call what you're practicing anything. You don't have to say, oh, this is A Course in Miracles. I don't even do that. I don't relate what I'm practicing directly to A Course in Miracles. Certainly, it came from that, but it's deeper than that. It comes from the Holy Spirit, actually. It comes from within. It comes from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit suggests to me, try this practice. Say, okay. So the real teacher is the grace of God within us, is the real teacher. That is the real teacher. And the grace of God is within everyone. Doesn't matter how they concretize this, as this Savior or that Savior or this or this or that. It doesn't matter. The grace of God is within everyone, period. And you can never leave because God put it there. We're all saved. Because we will all view the vision of oneness at some point, because the Holy Spirit will lead us there. The grace of God will lead us there. Everybody will be led there eventually. It's just some seem to be a little slower than others is the only thing. Or some seem to be a little quicker than others, a little bit, you know. But everyone will get there. So no worries on that account. We just want to get there soon, because the situation coming in the world is very, very nasty. And we should have seen it coming, right, with the Nazi Germany thing. We should have seen. This hasn't gone away, the ideology. And that was a trial run precursor to what's coming up. And so you don't become overly frightened. You need to be aware of this ahead of time, and you need to be centered in the vision of oneness, right spiritual practice, and then you will be adding calm to the world. It doesn't do any good to stick your head in the sand and say, let's not talk about this at all, because you're instilling fear in people. It doesn't do any good, because it's coming. So you need to be aware of what is coming, and then right orientation, so you can be a calming influence on the entire situation. Okay, that's what's going on, as far as I can see, and we will see what clarity comes up around this going forward. All right, very great, that's it.